the Masorti Foundation to take it over. Heidi.
Thank you, Gideon. And I want to welcome everyone here to our Masorti briefing with Rakefet Ginsberg and MK Alon Tal. A special thank you to our major donors who are joining us today, and also to our regular consistent donors who are joining us today, and all our supporters and future supporters who are joining us today to celebrate the ongoing vibrancy of the Masorti movement in Israel, which you are going to hear about. I am the chair of the Masorti Foundation, which is the United States fundraising arm for Masorti in Israel. And I want to share just a brief summary of my own Masorti story. I learned about Masorti when I went on a mission to Israel with my rabbi, Harold Kravitz, almost a dozen years ago. And while I was there, I heard Masorti rabbinic leaders and lay people call themselves pioneers and builders. And those words struck me so strongly. They spoke to us in Hebrew. They spoke to us in Spanish, in Russian, in French, and of course in English, which is my language. So they needed to speak English so I would understand what they had to say. They proclaimed their love of Zionism and their dedication to a dynamic Jewish life that could bring about Zionist ideals. They expressed their commitment to a spiritual inclusion of the entire diversity of Israeli citizens. I mean, people of all genders, all ethnic backgrounds, LGBTQ+, people of differing abilities. And they welcomed us as diaspora Jews and were grateful for our contributions as conservative Jewish life throughout the world and for our outreach and love of Israel. Well, after that mission, I couldn't look away. I couldn't turn away from Masorti. I knew I had to be a part of this incredible organization and these incredible people. And I joined the board, and the rest really kind of, I guess, is history. So I would love to hear your Masorti stories. If you are here today, I suspect you are here because you have your own Masorti story. And I would love to hear it if you want to put it in the chat, or if you would rather send it to me. I trust me, I will read it. You can send it to me at chair@masorti.org. I want to hear about how you, like me, have connected deeply with our movement in Israel. So today the foundation is privileged to share a conversation between Masorti's executive director, Rakefet Ginsberg, and MK Alon Tal. Both of them, I am happy to say, are active members of their Masorti Kehilot in Israel. Rakefet Ginsberg stepped into her role as the CEO in October of 2020. Yes, in the midst of a pandemic. I really don't need to say more. You can already tell Rakefet is fearless and she is determined and she is visionary. And that's why she stepped into this role in the middle of a pandemic. Before becoming our executive director for Masorti, she worked as Masorti's deputy director and also as the director of congregations and community development. She has a background in social work, a master's degree from Tel Aviv University, and her dedication to community building is absolutely vital to Masorti in Israel. She served as a community builder by coming to Milwaukee, Wisconsin, as an envoy for the Jewish Agency, and that's where she was introduced to conservative Judaism. Her experience in facilitating organizational change is a great asset to Masorti in Israel, and among other initiatives, she developed interventions and resilience training for Natal, the Israeli Trauma and Resilience Center. In her spare time, Rakefet serves as a volunteer chair for the Counseling Center for Women. Thank you for being here, Rakefet. MK Tal is a new member of the Israeli Knesset from the Blue and White Slate. He grew up in Raleigh, North Carolina, at a conservative shul. He came to Israel through the Young Judea Year program, and he made Aliyah and served as a paratrooper in the IDF under Benny Gantz. And now he's serving again under Defense Minister Benny Gantz, who leads the Blue and White Party. MK Tal is trained as a lawyer at Hebrew University, and he has a doctorate from Harvard in environmental health policy. He is the founder of the Israel Union of Environmental Defense and the Arava Institute for Environmental Studies. In addition, he chairs the Tel Aviv University Department of Public Policy. MK Tal has said that his priorities for this Knesset include environmental sustainability, the status of women close to our hearts at Masorti, religious pluralism, and ties to the diaspora, diaspora Jews, and the alienated progressive world, as he put it. MK Tal has said, it is a great honor to serve the third Jewish Commonwealth and to take part in celebration of Israel's democracy. MK Tal, we are honored to share this conversation about the challenges in today's Israel to building religious pluralism, especially Masorti, and to the opportunities that we can embrace with the new Israeli government to map the road ahead. And we look forward to even deeper engagement with Masorti in 2022 and with all of you on this call. Thank you again for your support, and thank you so much for joining us today. Rakefet, I will turn it over to you.
Thank you. Thank you. Can you hear me? Let me get this up. Okay. Hi, everyone. Hi, Alon. It's really a pleasure to be here with all of you. And it's really a pleasure to have Alon with us today and talk to him a little bit about his work, his amazing work. I want to just connect and say why for the Masorti movement it's so important to work with Knesset members in general and specifically with Alon Tal. The Masorti movement decided about 10 years ago that there's a need to be more active in the Israeli politics. It's important that the Israeli politics decide about different issues that relate to religious and state. And we as a movement are not involved, but many times are not even recognized or known for the Knesset members to consider our needs or our priorities. So about 10 years ago, the movement established an institution inside a movement that called Al Mishmar Knesset, Jewish Pluralism Watch, that the decision is that this is an organization, this is not organization, this is an institution that works with the Knesset members, do monitoring for different decisions and different discussions that happening in the Knesset, opinions about the Knesset members express, and also we've started lately to do some advocacy work with the Knesset members about things that relate to pluralistic Jewish life in Israel, how we can advocate and help the Knesset members to understand, to push on those decisions and to understand those issues when they discuss different other issues that doesn't seem relevant, but many times relevant for the pluralistic Judaism in Israel. Alon Tal, we're blessed to have a movement member in the Knesset as a representative this time. This Knesset is very unique. You know, we had 2 years of elections after elections, and we were in kind of a circle that never ends from one election to another. And having now a Knesset and having a coalition is something that's very, very important for us as a state in general and for the people in Israel. But having this specific coalition is very unique for us. Having Alon Tal in the coalition is very, very important and very special the way we work. And that's why we see the Jewish Pluralism Watch working even harder in the last few months since this coalition established. So Alon, it seems like it's a very, very, very busy time in the Knesset. People that worked in the Knesset before, you know, Knesset members that are more, I don't know how you say, that it's not their first Knesset already, say that this is one of the most active Knesset and coalition that was for many years. So I want to ask you first, if you have some regrets of being in the Knesset, or do you enjoy it?
Thanks, Rakefet. First of all, before I answer your question, I just wanted to thank you for hosting me and for inviting me. Thanks to Heidi for your work and Gideon. And when I scrolled through the participants this evening, I saw my friend Russell Smith, who I haven't had a chance to meet in quite some time, but Russell is quite an eminent attorney and environmentalist and leading member of the Addis Israel Synagogue. So hi, Russell, good to see you after quite some hiatus due to the corona. Anyway, it's great to be here. And do I regret being in the Knesset? Being in the Knesset is by far the best job in the world. Why would I regret it? You're with surrounded by interesting people, and there's a really good gym that you can work out at in the morning, even though they closed it today because of the Omicron variant. But the real thing is that you, after many years of being in civil society and trying very hard to influence Israel's reality, and one time after another, having my head hit that glass ceiling and realizing that there are just limits to what you can do if you're not part of the government, to be a member of Knesset in itself is a tremendous honor, particularly for someone who immigrated to Israel, but to be a member of a governing coalition and the so-called coalition of change, it's a once in a lifetime opportunity. I feel like it is, I live in Modi'in where we just finished the miracle of Hanukkah. I feel like miracles happen in Israel every day, and this just is another one. So yes, I'm delighted to be in the Knesset. I have no regrets. I just hope that it lasts for at least for 4 years.
Great, thank you, we need that. you worked many years, as you said, in civil society. You worked in especially environmental issues. You're not a traditional politician that was, you know, part of a group that ran every year, and you worked in the civil society really with your heart, and those who know you for many years know how devoted you are for that. How do you see the opportunities in this Knesset for environmental issues, but also of course for our issues as a pluralistic Judaism and Masorti Judaism?
So in our tradition, we talk about this concept of et ratzon. It's when the stars light up and presumably the gates of heaven are a little more open than they usually are, and we have this opportunity to really do something. And the Almighty is more engaged, you might say. And I really feel like, as somebody who's a sort of a person of faith, you could say, that we are really in the midst of such a moment that we've waited a very, very long time for the stars to line up this way. I don't think anybody predicted that we'd have this particular government. And the truth of the matter is it's unique in terms of what we can do for many reasons. The first of which is straight politics. Because there's a razor thin majority, only 61 members in the coalition and 59 in the opposition. As we say in Hebrew, that means that kol mamzer melech. If I make that, I'll make a direct translation. Every bastard is a king. In other words, members of Knesset who want to make trouble, you have the same thing in your Senate. I understand that schnook from Missouri is giving a hard time to President Biden too. But the point is that that there is a recognition by the part of the executive branch that they have to pay attention after 10 years of basically being dismissive of the legislative branch because of Israel's sort of idiosyncratic governance. And so there is an ability to get the attention. For example, I have a meeting next week with our Minister of Finance for 40 minutes where I'm going to talk to him about a lot of different issues. And I don't think he really wants to meet with me, but he knows that it's having a satisfied Alon is better than having one who's disgruntled. So he makes that initiative. So that's the first basic reason that it is. And the second thing is just the people that we are. All my life, I moved to Israel really, I came in after high school when I was just turned 17. And then I went back for a couple of years and then made Aliyah when I was 20 after college. And all my life, I kind of figured that I was a member of the great Anglo-American tribe of Israelis. But when I reached the Knesset, I found that I had been given a new nationality. I had all of a sudden become Scandinavian because my being in the Knesset is a direct result of the so-called Norwegian law. The Norwegian law is taken from the Norway's constitution, which allows a member of the parliament to resign and become a minister. But if they change their mind, they can go back. And in so doing, they can sort of have a safety net and make that leap of faith. And the idea was, is that when somebody's a minister, they shouldn't be wasting all their time suffering filibusters. They should be devoting their time to running the ministry and being an executive branch member. And they, at the same time, the legislative branch should be independent, should be have the time and resources and the focus on those things which legislatures do. So as part of the Norwegian law, many members of the Knesset moved on to the executive, and the three of them were in the blue and white party. So what happened with the Norwegians is that these were a group, I look at my sort of my fellow parliamentarians, there's only one really democratic party in the Knesset. Well, there's maybe more than one, but Likud is certainly an example, paragon of a democratic party, but it also shows all the negative things in the race to the bottom that happens in the Israeli political system when you have primaries. But almost all the parties, the rest of us, are either imperfect democracies or not democracies at all. I belong to a wonderful party, but it is not any kind of democracy. It is a benign autocracy, or whatever you would call it, because Benny Gantz decides, and the same is true of Yesh Atid, and the same is true of if you know these parties, Yisrael Beiteinu, and if the same is true of Yamina. What does this mean? It means that the chairs of the party pick people because they're good people, because they've done things in their life, because they may have be good team players. I think that's one of the characteristics. But most of us have real lives to go back to. This is not a desperate attempt to hold on to our chairs, but an opportunity to make the country a better place. And that dynamic is certainly felt so that, for example, I find that, you know, there's a sort of a long-held notion that in politics there's no real friendship, there's only sort of common interests. Well, that's nonsense. I am making very, very close friends in the Knesset, and we're working together. And although I recognize as somebody who champions environmental issues, I'll be fighting tooth and nail against all these other green champions because every party has their token green advocate. That'll happen 4 years from now in the election. Right now, we have to work together because the greater good is really driving our agenda. So I feel like we're surrounded by good people with integrity, who are idealistic, who work really hard. I mean, you can go on the Knesset website and see just how many hours we're in the Knesset. And then we're out of the Knesset, it's even more work because you start at 5 and you end up doing Zooms till 9 o'clock at night here, 9:30, whatever this is gonna go to. So yes, I'm surrounded by good people. And I really feel, and this is the main thing, that this is a government committed to change, and we have this window of opportunity. So there's so many things we need to do now, as Hillel the Zaken said, in lo achshav imatai, in Pirkei Avot, if not now, when? This is the time when we can really reclaim Israel as the kind of Jewish state that we all dreamed of.
Thank you. You know, it's a very complicated Knesset as well. It's a very complicated coalition. This is a 61-59 coalition and opposition, which means, as you said, each one is very, very important. But at the same time, it's very complicated because the parties that build this coalition are very different from each other. And I want to give one example that is very relevant for the audience here, I think. When we talk about the Kotel, for example, I don't know how many of you know that Alon has daughters that were in Noam and very active in Noam and actually took part many times, I think, in the Women of the Wall prayers in Rosh Chodesh. So the Kotel and prayers at the Kotel and and working for the cartel agreement is a very important issue. And we all try and thought when this coalition was built that this is going to be a very easy because most of the coalition members are pro or want this agreement to get forward and have this decision on the government's table means that it can be very easy now. And still we see that going back and forward. Still we see different ministers talk against it or try to postpone it. It's a complicated coalition. What do you think about this agreement specifically? And how do you think this coalition can work to make those decisions that are hard for her?
Okay, so as I think was mentioned by Heidi at the outset, I did grow up in a conservative synagogue. It started in Durham, North Carolina, at Beth El Synagogue, and then Beth Meir Synagogue. And I was always taught that Jews do not sanctify places. We are not people who build giant cathedrals. We don't make graven images and the like. And that's why we don't know the burial place of Moses, because we don't want that to turn into some sort of a... And so I have a sort of a visceral dislike or visceral... hesitation to make, you know, a wall of stones, be they ancient, when notwithstanding their great historical meaning, to be the focus of my prayer. And that was sort of my gut feeling about this issue for a long time. But the truth of the matter is that the battle over the access to the Kotel and how we're going to observe it there has become a symbolic almost litmus test for the health of the Israeli democracy and the freedom of faith and religion in the country. My daughters, not only were they active in Noam, which is the USY of Israel, but two of them were the national chairs. So they were radicalizing me. And when I saw what they were up against, and I made a speech about this in the Knesset, the amount of violence, my daughter Zoe just now finished the army. She was in a garin, a group of people from the Noam conservative movement who went and served in the army together. And she was a combat soldier. And I never worried about her, even though she was in somewhat delicate situations overseeing the occupation of the West Bank. But I worried a lot when she would go to the Kotel. And it wasn't just that she would be physically abused, as many members of our movement have been, by the violent activity around them, but also that the toxic level of hatred and really prejudice and angriness would somehow seep into her soul, and that she would start to hate the ultra-Orthodox and the people who are fomenting this kind of antagonism towards our way of looking at Judaism. She would hate them as much as they would start to hate them as much as they hate her. And that was something that always worried me. And I feel like I'm very blessed that my daughters retain their sanity and their goodwill and the recognition that the ultra-Orthodox and the national Orthodox are not our enemies. We, you know, they're our cousins. They're misled maybe on this particular issue, but there's no room for us to have what we call sinat chinam, or, you know, sort of gratuitous hatred. But I do feel that this is an issue which we have to move forward on. Now, speaking from the Blue and White Party, I can tell you that when we were established, it was originally called the Israel Resilience Party, and then we morphed into Blue and White. In Benny Gantz's maiden speech, his first opening declaration and proclamation as a politician, he said that we are going to promote, I went back and read it, the text, we are going to promote the Kotel arrangement law or the Kotel agreement. And then later, during the first election at the AIPAC convention, he made a very profound statement. He said, I am a proud paratrooper. That's when I first met Benny. He said, and the paratroopers liberated the Western Wall. And I can tell you firsthand that that wall is long enough for all streams of Judaism. So that is something which is extremely built into the DNA of this brand new party, or not so new now, three-year-old party, Blue and White. In fact, tomorrow I have a meeting with Benny Gantz at 7 p.m. Israel time. And one of the issues of this is, how are we going to do this? And I've discussed it with him in the past. He knows how committed I am. And I'm grateful for Benny for coming to our conservative synagogue in Maccabim, where I'm for many years have been the gabbai and lighting a candle and showing his solidarity. So I think that we need to recognize what we're up against. And I just want people to understand a little bit of the politics here. And I'm sorry if I'm going to be political, but that's just who I am. And if you're on the right side of the political spectrum, I mean you no offense. But the fact of the matter is that Bibi Netanyahu, our former prime minister, has made great historic contributions to Israel, but he made a colossal miscalculation. And in his insistence on not stepping down, given the fact that there are indictments against him, he created a situation where he lost control of the government. And then he assumed that he would bring down this very, very unusual and esoteric coalition before the budget. And he failed there again. And he feels that his base is slipping through his fingers, that his coalitional partners that he has browbeaten to being so loyal to him, the ultra-Orthodox, the national religious parties that are with him. And so he's trying to find a way to hold on to that power. And tragically, and I often liken this process to the, if you are familiar with Star Wars, to what happened to Darth Vader, whose soul got rotten inside. He has gone over to the dark side. In other words, taking the hateful, spiteful tweets of Shas leaders and retweeting them puts him on the wrong side of history and is a disgrace to everything the Likud party stand for. I say to somebody whose grandfather was a chanich, was a student of Jabotinsky and who built the first Beitar revisionist camp in California and was a friend, great friend of Menachem Begin. And I would think they would be appalled because what that party originally stood for was just the kind of religious freedom that we are expecting from Israel to guarantee us. So it's a very long answer. So given that circumstances, we have to realize what we're up against. It's not going to happen. Now, we went to the president, and Rakefet can give you more details when she talks. We went to the president's house, and he asked to give him a little bit of time to work things out quietly. And I'm all in favor of working things out quietly. I don't see any reason to make this a violent or, but at the end of the day, we have to realize that just because you're moderate in the center doesn't mean you're weak. We need to be a muscular middle of the road perspective. And so we have been polite and we've been patient, but at some point you have to draw the line. And I think I personally drew the line at this month of Shvat that's coming up soon. But that's what I think I'm going to do. I have already submitted a bill into the Knesset, which the way the protocols are of Israel's Knesset works, or the rules of operation, is you have to submit a bill in for 45 years so it can be reviewed by the legal staff. And then only after that can you submit it to the Ministerial Committee for Legislation. So the Ministerial for Legislation has to recommend it or not, and then you put it forward. So I'm sort of waiting to see if this is needed. I was very hopeful when I put in the law that the government, the cabinet would make a decision which would make it superfluous, that they would have the temerity and follow up on their commitments to make a government decision. But there are signs that suggest that they are dragging their feet, and particularly Amina has its base, and they're finding excuses. And so tomorrow I'm going to start talking to my party chairman about what I can do as an individual member. And remember, there's a reform rabbi, a good friend, and a good friend of the conservative movement, Gilad Kariv. The two of us can bring down the government. Now, I'm not a troublemaker. I'm a pretty disciplined, well-behaved member of parliament. But I have principles too. And at some point, you have to play politics. And so coordination with my party chairman, I hope that we will be more active on this issue. I think I'll leave it at that.
Thank you. You said something beautifully when we were at the president's house, when you said about being a Jew in US compared to being a Jew now in Israel. You want to repeat on that? Because it was really, I think it was really beautiful to hear that. And the president was very impressed. I mean, it made a change in the talk there.
Okay, yeah, what I said was basically, I grew up in North Carolina, a wonderful Jewish community. Two Jewish communities, but it was in North Carolina. There are not a lot of Jews in North Carolina. We had a senator named Jesse Helms. There was a great tradition of racism, and people were a little bit uneasy. And the basic unspoken modus operandi of the Jewish communities in North Carolina in those days, and I'm sure it's changed now, but in the 1970s and 80s, or 80s, I was already in Israel, but 1970s was, don't rock the boat. Don't make trouble. We have to know our place. We're fully recognized citizens. There's a civil rights act, but we shouldn't overdo it. And so one of the reasons that I kind of felt that Zionism was compelling for me was that I don't want to have to be polite. I don't want to have to feel like I'm a second class citizen or that I have to be very careful, because if I rock the boat, I might actually get my community into trouble. And basically what the president was saying to us was, listen, it's not a good time to go to the press. It's not a good time to mobilize world Jewry on this issue. Better to sort of play quietly and not rock the boat. And it pushed a button with me. And I said, you know, I don't need to be right. I'd rather be smart than right. Okay, as that expression goes in Hebrew. But at some point, the reason I came to Israel is I wouldn't have this dynamic of feeling it. And with all due respect, the community I represent, who pays taxes, who goes to the army, who serves in the elite units, who is the best citizens, we're not the ones who need to be cowering here. We need the ones who need to, and there is a coalition that we are part of and we are leading. So I'm hopeful that we can work things out amiably. I think we'd all rather avoid the kind of strife, and nobody wants to have a civil war in Israel. But at the end of the day, that can't come from us, you know, collapsing or giving up and conceding our principles. So that's mostly what I said.
I must say that when he said, keep on low profile, and you said, no, this is not why I'm here. I'm here not to be a low profile anymore. That was, you know, we were also, it felt like we could see it and say, yes, we do have a right now to speak up and say, this is our time. So I want to thank you personally for saying that in this meeting and having this. Alon, you were elected to the Knesset. Actually, you were elected in Kahol Levan as part of the environmental movement. And you are a very, very active Masorti movement. I don't know if you know, but Alon is a great Shliach Tzibur in his community, one of the best. How do you see the environmental issues and the fact that you're representing that and the pluralism, Jewish pluralism, how that connect to each other? How do you bring both of them? How do you hold both of them? Do you see any connections between those two issues that you bring?
Well, I do think that environmentalism and Judaism are largely synonymous ways of looking at the world. And we just finished the book of Bereshit, the first book of the Bible, this Shabbat. And if you go through the Bible, it's almost like an ecological primer, you know, from the way we think about the Garden of Eden and the balance between, you know, guarding it, protecting it, and working it. That's sort of the basis of sustainable development. And of course, the implications of the Noah and the Ark and what that means for biodiversity. And you could go on with the carrying capacity that Abraham recognized was important in his discussions with Lot, and on and on and on. It's just the environmental messages are profound. And often in the times in the Knesset, I will try to bring in Jewish sources to make my point, because there are a lot of religious members of Knesset and not all of them are so green. And I try to make that argument. In this particular coalition, it's not a hard case to make. We have a lot of people who care about the environment. And so I wouldn't even say I'm the most radical amongst them. Maybe I have the most degrees and have the most published articles in academic journals, but I think I have a lot of support. We have a wonderful Minister of Environment, Tommy Zandberg, from the Meretz Party, who was in the Army service, a teacher for the Nature Reserve Authority, for the Parks Authority. So she's a vegan and the first vegan minister I think we have. So there's many, many partners in the parliament, and they also get it. And I think that it's very important as we try to find ways to engage a younger generation in Judaism. We all know that Jewish continuity is our common challenge, and not just the United States. The level of Jewish literacy in Israel has always been fairly lacking. I always say that Jews in America, often the ones that I grew up with, were very high on consciousness and low on content. And Israeli youth were sort of high on content, but low on consciousness. But if we want to bring them to a sense of feeling really proud and inspired by their tradition, we have to find things to reach them. And one of the interesting phenomena of the last 2-3 years is this notion that climate change has become a defining issue for a generation. I don't think since the Vietnam War brought the kind of peace commitment amongst the young people of the United States. We've seen another issue to get people so excited, and it started maybe with Greta Thunberg, then a high school student in Sweden, but it's really taken over the globe, and Israeli young people, they care about this passionately, and they are prowling the Knesset, pushing us, and we have a large high school, spontaneous, using Facebook, and they are making this an issue. And I think this is an opportunity for us at our educational work to bring in the Jewish environmental perspective, which is really so well enunciated in our own movement. You get some of the leading rabbis have written about this so very, very brilliantly. Brad Artson in California, and Rabbi Shorsh, who was head of the JTS, has written just brilliant stuff on these issues. And we really need to, and of course, the ultimate ecological rabbi, of course, being Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel, who probably did more to define my own personal way of looking at the world environmentally than anybody else. I mean, the earth is the Lord's and all this stuff like that, and radical amazement. And what does that mean for us as people in terms of respecting the earth? So we have this tradition. And I think that the challenge for all of us is how can we translate it, build it into our curriculum and make, there's a lot of Jewish environmental organizations, but the largest one should be the conservative movement. That's what I think.
I think it's very important what you're saying, because this is a way for us to get more young people involved in politics and what does it mean to run, you know, the world, not just their own life. How we all have to get together to do some change, and we bring them to do that. But I want to say or ask you that in another perspective, because when we see the global warming in general, we see more violence, and we know today that global warming helped or increase the violence among different groups in the society, because there are less resources, but at the same time, even the level of the temperature gets people more and more. How do you see this resolve between different groups of Jews when we go more and more into, you know, diversity that sometimes create two separate groups, to split between groups? How do you see those groups come together? How do you see this state stays as a one, not just Jewish, but mainly Jewish community, Jewish country?
Well, I think that actually the environment is one area where we can all recognize our common commitment. And it's not just even between Jews within Israel and different streams, it's also between Arabs and Jews as well. But I work with all parties in Israel on environmental legislation. And I think it's one area where they recognize that we can agree in other areas. Now, you know, there was some areas where I felt like the ultra-Orthodox were misrepresenting Judaism on the issue. We recently, this government just put a tax on disposable plates and cutlery. And I thought that was a very important thing, because Israel, it turns out, is the world's leader per capita use of, you know, disposable plates. And it's largely because of Orthodox Jews and ultra-Orthodox that have large families. And on Shabbat, they don't want to have to wash so many dishes. And what I said in the committee when we discussed and we passed it, and the law, it's now law. And since the law has come through, by the way, the consumption of disposed plates has dropped and dramatically. But what I explained to them was that I quoted an ultra-Orthodox Jew who talked about how much money he saved. But I said, look, I have a big Friday night dinner table too. My parents live in town, and we have friends always over. And I always wash the dishes. And I said, if one of my daughters was to put a plastic plate or a fork on the table, it would be like tselem be'echal, like putting a graven image in the temple. I mean, it would be, because it wouldn't be kosher. It would be destroying the planet. And I talked about what's happening to the biodiversity in the sea with all the plastic. And, you know, I think they kind of agreed with me. They couldn't exactly say it at the time, but afterwards they said, you know, even Gaffney was the head of the, so yeah, so I think we have a lot to work together on in that area. Yeah.
Well, we're going to go to questions from the audience in a second. I just want to ask you one last question. What is the thing, if you can choose one thing that you really want to accomplish, one decision, one rule, one thing that you think this is going to be something that this is the legacy that I'm going to leave behind me as a Knesset member? What will be the one?
I got seven laws. You're making me like choose between my seven children. What am I going to like better, the forestry law or the or the ecological corridors law. There is a law which I want to pass, which I'm very passionate about. During the COVID-19 lockdowns in Israel, Israelis were limited in their geographical, the region they could go out of. We're not like America, we're much more regulated. And people would go a little bit beyond that, but basically you couldn't drive in your car because the police would stop you and give you a fine. And so people began to walk and rediscover all these wonderful natural sites. And so I am working on a bill. We have now a wonderful system in Israel of nature reserves, and we have a wonderful bill of a group of national parks. But there's all these beautiful sites which will be built on because Israel's population is growing at a ridiculously high rate and the development of these sites. And so we would like to make a nature reserve and for cities. And 10 days ago, I met with our Minister of Interior, Yaela Shaked, and I was sure she's not a very green or prosperous person, as I thought she was going to be dead set against it. I would have no chance because the Ministry of Interior is in charge of the local authorities. And she said to me, I think that's a wonderful idea. And I was like, beam me down. This is fantastic. So we're really going to move this forward nicely. Before we go to the questions from the audience, I just want to say a word to them in it because I don't know if I'll get the chance. And that is this. When I first moved to Israel, was not what I would say an identifiable conservative Masorti Jew. In other words, I was observant. I went to services. I had decided that I wanted to observe Sabbath, whatever. I went to Orthodox and all different kinds of synagogues. And then when I went to graduate school at the Harvard School of Public Health, I was the synagogue that I could closest walk to was the Chabad Synagogue at Boston University. And I went there for very happily for 2 years. And then there was a crisis surrounding the who is a Jew question. And the Lubavitcher rabbi came out with a really insidious statement and very dismissive of the conservative Jewish world. And it was an eye opener for me. And the great writer Dante once said, the hottest places in hell are reserved for those who in time of moral crisis sit and do nothing. And I said, this is a moral crisis. There is a battle for the soul of Judaism. And at that very moment, I stopped going to Chabad and I walked 3.5 miles each way to Brooklyn to go to the conservative synagogue then. And I really started to identify because I felt like we are in the midst of a cultural war. Let there be no doubt. I want to resolve this war peacefully, but there's very different ways of looking at the world and what is the role of halakha and what kind of Jewish Judaism we want to have. Should it be a dark chauvinistic one, one which is homophobic, one which doesn't see any ability to evolve with the modern world, or one which is inclusive, one which embraces universal values, one which has a strong balance between our tradition and innovation. So I'm very proud of becoming a Masorti Jew, and I've become very, very involved in the movement. I've had the honor of representing the Masorti movement and the conservative movement at the Jewish National Fund International Board for about 12 years. But most of all, I've just enjoyed being a member of the synagogue, letting my daughters grow up in a wonderful conservative synagogue. And one of the reasons I could do that was because the world Jewry, and particularly American Jewry, had been so very generous in making contributions to the Masorti movement. In other words, it wasn't enough that they had to pay for their overpriced synagogues and the high salaries of the American rabbis, and I don't begrudge them any of it, but they also found room in their charitable portfolios to support us. And it meant a lot to me. I know it allowed me to raise children a different way. And I just want to say that recently in the Knesset, they decided, the Minister of Finance, because he wanted to sort of make sure that all of us Knesset members were happy. So he decided to buy us off, and everybody got about $1 million, actually more, about $1.2 million. They could spend on anything that was already sort of a budget island in there. You couldn't just, go out and say, I want to buy ice cream for my friends, but you could put it on issues that were already in the budget and expand those issues. And I was given that opportunity, and I said, well, then I want us to put that money in for conservative and reform rabbis, which is a budget item in the Ministry of Culture. And I was delighted that I was able to do so. It meant a lot to me. And I thought it was very important as a message to my brothers and sisters in the conservative around the world, that when we in the Israeli conservative movement have a chance to contribute, we do contribute according to our means, and they had this opportunity. And I think that Israel is a much wealthier country than we used to be. We need to pick up our fair share of the burden, but we are in this together, and it is a homeland that we share together. And if we're going to let this whole land this holy land for all of us in our promised land be hijacked by ultra-Orthodox Jewry or not, that depends on us. I said before, if we don't do it in this next 4 years during this government, we're going to not be able to give our grandchildren and children the kind of Israel that we've enjoyed. So I would ask you to stay the course, and I want to thank you for being so generous and ask you to continue to be generous, because I believe that we now have an opportunity to really go far beyond where we were in the past and not be a persecuted minority, but to be part of the same majority, which reclaims a pluralistic Israel that we all can be proud of. There.
We are very lucky to have you as a advocate for us in the Knesset, as a Knesset member of this movement that helped us a lot. And I must say, in every issue that we had in the last few months, Alon was stepping up for us and still do that and help us very much. And the fact that we as a movement can be represented at the Knesset is a very unique issue, a very unique opportunity for us that we didn't have before. And we feel that. So thank you. The nation of Israel is fortunate to have you as a Knesset member, and we as a movement specifically, you know, enjoy that.
I'm lucky to have a movement behind me like the conservative movement, so everybody benefits. Let's have some questions from the participants. They've been waiting.
Of course. So Gideon, do you want to ask the questions? Great. Yeah.
So first of all, thank you again. And I'm going to run through questions and encourage people to keep sending them, and I'll pull them out of the chat and ask them. One question that was asked by quite a number of people, and it's something I know for us at the Masorti Foundation and our community around the United States is really on the front of our mind, is what is your response to the recent decision in the specific case of Yosef Kibita and the issue of how Israel can be a welcoming home for the Abu Yudaya Jews of Uganda? And I'll add also, if you several people asked for guidance and advice on what we can do from our side of the ocean to help Yosef and the Abu Yudaya community.
Well, it's a germane issue. You guys, in today's world with internet, you're not any steps behind the rest of us. This past Friday night, I was visiting Kibbutz Keturah. A friend of mine was sitting Shiva. So I went to meet with Yosef at the house of Rabbi Sarah Cohen, who's adopted him as a member of the kibbutz. And so I got a chance to talk to him about his circumstances. And this morning I spent about 20 minutes speaking with his attorney, who was a very gifted, works at the legal center that I think Reform Judaism does, but she's taken this case and she's quite brilliant and competent. I
just want to say that she's a Masorti member as well from my congregation, but this is just Nikki is part of Yadid Nefesh.
Come over, because I think she made Aliyah in a Reform context, but she saw the light. So my feeling is that this is a big issue, and it's a strategic issue. And I said to him, I said, look, I have no doubt that I could speak with the Minister of Interior, describe your personal circumstances, and allow her the opportunity to make a quick exception and let's resolve this quietly. And he was fairly defiant in his unwillingness to do that. And he said, no, this isn't just about me. This is about the legitimacy of conservative rabbis' conversions. And I'm not trying to solve my own problem. I represent a community that made a conscious decision to join Masorti International Conservative Judaism. And therefore, I don't want a quiet solution to my problem. I want this resolved so that all of my people and all the people who are recognized as Jews by conservative rabbis can be welcomed into Israel. That's a lot more challenging position, to be sure. When I spoke with our Minister of Immigration and Absorption, who's a member of my party, she's an Ethiopian Jew by the name of Pnina Tamanashato. She's also a former student of mine from Tel Aviv University School of Public Policy. So we have a wonderful relationship. So I spoke with her people, I haven't spoken with her yet, and was disappointed in the response. The response was, we don't really define who's Jewish. That's the Ministry of Interior's job. There's only two Jewish communities outside of Israel that are sort of these emerging communities. One of them is Ethiopian, and one of them is the B'nai Menasheh, who are in India, and they're the ones who we do everything we can to bring them over, but we don't have that authority. And I felt very, very disappointed for two reasons. First of all, the reason why those two communities are recognized is because it was Orthodox rabbis who championed them. The second, that a very clearly Jewish community was highlighted by conservative rabbis, all of a sudden they're not good enough. I was also disappointed because the every time there's a question about the legitimacy of an Ethiopian Jew's Judaism, Pnina is fighting all the way. There was a very dramatic incident, open parentheses to tell a story, that when there was a woman who was fighting with the rebels from Tigris, and she was not allowed in because they said she'd converted to Christianity. And then, and Pnina fought for her because she is Jewish. And then there was, I don't know if you guys saw it, it was sort of picked up peripherally in the Israeli press. And she had a meeting with our Minister of Interior about this issue, Ayala Chaked, and Ayala Chaked's bodyguard came up to her. He was Ethiopian, and he started to cry. And Pnina said, "What's the matter?" He said, "I want to thank you. You saved my mother," because his mother was this woman that the Interior Ministry said wasn't Jewish. And he said, and she said, "You see?" So she knows, she's a scrapper and a fighter, and I don't see any difference in my mind. There's no question in mind, if these Jews had been from Ukraine and had white skin, I'll be completely frank about this, I don't think there'd be any question about that. Everybody welcomed them in. But because they're from Uganda, and we don't know, there's only like, he claims 800, the Haaretz said 2,000, there's not that many of them, but they are Jewish, and we need to recognize and embrace this and help them. So that's my, how am I gonna do it? I don't know, I'm gonna start talking to people. And immediately we have to do is, what we have agreed to do is we're gonna try to get him a permit to stay in the country for another 3 months and let this go through the courts, because the Supreme Court has been supportive of the conservative conversion. So we wanna try to make sure, now we had court case will go through, but I'd rather go through when he's working happily on Kibbutz Torah on the Arava than when if he's sent back to Uganda, as is presently on in the case. So stay tuned. I don't have any, particularly cheerful new messages on this, but Rakefet has sort of held my feet to the fire on this and sent me all the relevant documents by WhatsApp. And so I guess I'm engaged. I don't know if I can deliver, but I'll try.
I think you can help as well. I mean, I think if everyone on this call today, in this Zoom, going to write a letter to the consulate, to the ambassador in US, and send and say, we care about Yosef Kibita. We know it's going on. We know it's happening. You know, Yair Lapid, the minister, the foreign minister, when he'll get the message from different places, when Pnina Tamanoshata will get the message from different places, when Ayelet Shaked will hear the message from different places, this is an important thing. It's important for all of us around the world, conservative movement, to say, our rabbis, our conversion is totally legitimate. And if we decided that this person is a Jew and we accepted him to Judaism, it's acceptable exactly as everybody else, every other rabbi in Israel. So this is something that you all can state, send letters, emails. It's important.
Can we get operational about this? Rakefet, send them, three people need to get it. Certainly the foreign minister and the maybe the American ambassador, but also Pnina should get letters, and Ayala Chaked. And then if they got, 1,000 emails from America saying, this is outrageous. And if somebody would write an op-ed piece, some decision, somebody influential person in the New York Times, the Washington Post, and said, this is crazy that Israel is taking what I believe to be a racist policy, because I can't have no other explanation. Because the conversion of a Jew by a conservative rabbi in Bethesda, Maryland is completely kosher. But somehow or other, if it takes place in Ethiopia, it's invalid. I don't get that. Doesn't work for me. And Israel has become a much more colorblind country. We do embrace our Ethiopian minority. Why don't we do this for the Ugandans? So yeah, I think, but Kevin, let's get them the email addresses. This is not rocket science. And get your synagogues and get your community groups going, and let's get a petition happening. I think that we can win this one. This is still not resolved. We're making Jewish history as we speak. That's the whole reason to live in Israel, that exciting moment that we're defining what this Jewish state is. And this is a defining moment.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And again, the foundation will work with the movement to share this advocacy information with everyone in the beginning of the week. A question here from Russell Smith on the environmental issues. Russell asks, says, Israel until just recently didn't have to consider the trade-off between exploiting fossil fuels and deep investment in sustainable energy sources. Has that changed since the major offshore oil and gas discoveries? Separately, can you talk about the amount of unrecognized cross-border Palestinian-Jewish cooperation that environmentalism has generated?
Okay, two questions that I could talk about. Each one could be a whole Zoom session, but I'll try to distill it down to the basics. With regard to this, Israel has undergone a massive change in perspective. And of course, you know, I'll start, I haven't told any jokes, and God, environmentalists can be so dreary. So I'll tell a joke that was Golda Meir's favorite joke, okay? And she wasn't that funny either, but this was her only joke that I think she told. She used to say, you know, people always say Jews are so smart. We're not so smart. Why? What other people would wander the desert for 40 years to go to the only place in the Middle East that doesn't have oil? Okay, that was her joke. But she can't tell the joke anymore because we have fantastic gas reserves in the Mediterranean Sea. Unbelievable, copious quantities, a surfeit of gas. And Israel was, when they found it, there was a great deal of euphoria because natural gas is so much cleaner than coal, which we were producing our electricity, and all of a sudden we would be energy independent and we'd make all this money and we're going to have a fund like Norway, and it's all great. There's only one problem. Natural gas is 80 times more polluting a methane molecule than carbon dioxide, and we can't use that gas because if we use it, we're going to be part of the problem that is going to cook this planet for the future generations. So there were there was a period we looked at natural gas as a transition fuel, but now we've got to make the leapfrog to renewables. And God bless him, Joe Biden has made that commitment. In 2035, America's going to be 100% renewable. And Israel needs to be there too, okay? So what's happened is, and I'm very happy, by the way, I'll make a shout out. If you're not on my Facebook page, I have a public page. I have a private private friends, but my public page has, it's in Hebrew, but it's, for those of you who want to practice the Hebrew, you should do so. So you should go on there. But every week we try to have an environmental hero. Okay, it's a little corner there, and it's a little bit, maybe a little presumptuous that I decide who's this was environmental Hebrews, but what the hell? It's been going on for several months and it seems to get a lot of likes. So just the day before yesterday, Friday, we had that week's environmental hero, and we gave it to Karin Elarar, who is our Ministry of Energy. And why did we do that? Karin Elarar, by the way, is a hero anyway, because she's got multiple sclerosis. She's in a wheelchair, and she's an academic who's been a politician, and she's a remarkable woman for Yesh Atid. And for me to say that for a competing party means that she must be something, because I'm in direct heat with Yesh Atid for my political future, but she is an astonishing woman. But she said something great this week. They have a conference every year in Eilat Eilot about renewable energy. And she went down there and she said, I am not giving any more licenses either to look for oil on the land, which is, there's a couple of them out there in the Arva, but none to search for more gas in the Mediterranean. There's more than enough reserves, and we need to be getting off, we need to be moving towards renewables. And boy, did she take the heat from all the economic newspapers and everything like that, but it was a bold move. She's not the first politician to say it. Miki Chaimovich said it 3 years ago, and people thought she was crazy. And she ended up losing the job of Minister of Environment because of it. But Karin said it and didn't blink. And she was named by Alon Tal to be the environmental hero of the week, and she deserves it. So that's what's happening, Russell, that there is a change. And although there was in the past, I think, a great deal of euphoria surrounding the gas, there's now more circumspection. I'll tell you one more story. Before we went to Glasgow, we had a sort of a pep rally of all the members of the coalition because we were about to go into the budget voting, and they wanted us to be rah-rah because it's a very hard thing to we were up for about 48 hours straight voting on this. And so they all had a stand-up coming. Anyway, all of us came in, all 61 of us. And there was Bennett there, the Prime Minister Bennett. And just that morning, he had changed Israel's commitment from 80% emissions, 80% reduction of greenhouse gas emissions by 2050 to join that elite club of people who say by 2050, no net greenhouse gas emissions. And I went up to him and I said, I want you to know how much I appreciate this. I know, I mean, said it, he mamash ma'arich et zeh. And Bennett, you know, his mother tongue is English. And he oftentimes talks to me in English. And he said, Alon, we had to do it sooner or later. And I said, you're telling tough sooner, huh? So I think that we are in a transition. And even Bennett was, I think going to Glasgow was transformational. He's kind of feeling the pace, the pulse of the world there. And I'm hopeful that Israel's climate policy will be a good one. Now, with regard to the transboundary issues, I can only say that I am trying very hard to use the good offices of the Minister of Defense in this regard, but right now is not a good time for me to go beyond that. But there's a lot of quiet things going on. I'm hopeful that soon they won't be so quiet, but I'm aware of this issue. I set up an institute to promote it, and hopefully we'll be able to deliver something soon.
A couple of quick questions relating to protection of people and conflict between Jews in Israel from David Parker and from Gloria Beeler. We have a question about the failure to protect the egalitarian area at the Kotel and harassment of people in prayer by ultra-Orthodox provocateurs, which in any other country would be considered anti-Semitism. We also have the question, let me start with that and I'll ask a follow-up question afterwards.
So this is our great collective disgrace on this issue, that we have allowed not only for the Kotel to become an ultra-Orthodox synagogue, but we have allowed for the security of that ultra-Orthodox synagogue to be overseen by a private army headed by the ultra-Orthodox rabbi of the Western Wall. And the police, and it's just like in the Knesset, by the way, it's extraterritorial. The Israeli police can't go in there. We have our own private police force. For some reason or other, a private Kotel, Western Wall fund, has these ushers that are in charge of security there. And they understand that they have a boss who doesn't seem to bother him when brave, pious women who want to pray on Rosh Chodesh go down there to pray. It doesn't bother him that they get beaten up and spit on and abused physically. And that is a great disgrace. Recently, and Rakefet can give you more details because she's there, I'm not allowed in there. The police have become engaged more, and our Minister of Internal Defense, who's a labor minister, has taken this on. I know I went up to him personally, thank him for being more engaged. We saw it also in the Tisha B'Av events, where there was also people came to destroy it, and he sent in a couple of police, and eventually he sent them packing. That was a little slower, but I think he realizes the... Last night, somebody leaked a video of Yair Lapid, our deputy prime minister or our co-prime minister, who said that indeed any other country that would not allow women to read Torah in a woman's area would be considered anti-Semitic. So that's coming from pretty high places. But yes, you can't condemn it enough. It's an embarrassment, but we just have to, instead of, it's enough with the words, we're now responsible. We're now in the coalition, so let's just change it.
So I'll ask an associated question and then also ask Rakefet to comment on this as well. How do you see the ways to address increasing violence between Jews of different traditions, as well as between Jews and Palestinians at this moment, as influenced by climate change, poverty, educational failures?
Wow. I'll let you have that, Rakefet. That's a hard question. That's complicated. That's like three questions in one.
Wow, this is a big question. This is a really big one. I want to start with the end of the Alon's answer before about the Kotel, because I think many of those disagreements are not about big issues. For many things, we can find solutions if we talk to each other. Many times it's an issue of between politicians that I don't want to use the word use us, but in a way they do to fight for different opinions. It's not necessarily that we have such a disagreement. At the same time, I think if we're all aware or more aware that we need to live together, this is something special. Alon's coalition, I've said that before, this is a different a coalition. It builds from very, very different parties, some from the right and some from the left, some like Meretz on one hand and Yamina on the other hand, Lieberman, which is a very right as well, with Labor. I think if a year ago somebody would have said, you know, this is going to be the coalition, none of us could believe in that. I mean, we were all like, He's crazy. It will never happen. It means that it's possible if we look, if we understand that this is the need. And I think that what happened in this coalition, the politicians understood that this is a need. This is an immediate need. They have disagreements, but it doesn't matter. They have to find the common situation or the common things that they can share and do that together. And I think as a society, it's the same thing. We won't agree about everything. You know, I've visited Rabbi Melamed, which is an ultra-Orthodox rabbi, a few months ago after the fightings, I can't call it in another word, that were in Tisha B'Av at the egalitarian Kotel. When I met him, one of the first sentences or one of the first things that we said, we will disagree. We are not here to agree about everything. One thing we both here to understand, that this is something that we have to do together. We will disagree, but we have to live together. Now let's talk. Now let's find what are the things that we must have together and what are the things that each one of us can do separately. And I think it's the same thing about this community in Israel, this religious fightings that we see between Jews and Arabs and between Jews. And unfortunately, many times it seems like it's going to get into a violent situation. It's going to be hard. But at the same time, if we can stop and look at each other and understand that this is a must for us, there is no other way. We won't agree, but we'll find a way to live together. I think as in the Western Wall, and the same thing about almost every public place in Israel, we can find a solution. We can find a way in the middle that is not a compromise. It's a real need. It's a real thing that we need to do together.
I would just say something to bring this sort of to the American reality. I think we all in Israel were transfixed and terrified by the events of January at the Capitol. And it was a wake-up call where we are heading as a society, where there are two sides of the political map that just can't seem to get it together. And the level of enmity and it was just, so I think that for many of us, we've said, wow, that we don't want to go there. And I know that in Israel, there's a lot of things that unite us, for example, the environment. Right-wing Israelis are just as committed to climate change and environmental protection as anybody on the left side. But that event was sort of a holding our mirror and said, that's where we're going. And as a country, Israel was there. I mean, if you remember back in 1948, when the Irgun tried to bring in arms with Al-Talina, and David Ben-Gurion shot at the ship and people were killed, and it was Jew against Jew, and Menachem Begin, I think, in a remarkably heroic decision, decided to not fire back and capitulated, because he realized that that's the only way, and we can never go back there. I mean, you can argue whether Ben-Gurion was right or not to fire on the Al-Talina, but we don't want to be, we have enough external enemies to justify just a thimble full of common sense that we need to work together. So hopefully we will.
So we have several questions on the scope of the pluralism agenda. And if you could talk about the outlook for these issues in the current Knesset and from the change government in the areas of public transportation on Shabbat, on expansion of who can regulate kashrut, on equality for marriages conducted by the various streams, and in the area of equality of budgets. And I'll just add a quick question from Rick Tavon, who I think gets back to your Hillel quote. He says, Jews are the only Israelis who don't have religious freedom. When will this be fixed? So if not now, when?
Okay, we'll leave that as a rhetorical question. All those issues you raise are complicated, and I'll explain why. This government has two sides, but there's a right-wing side, which involves two parties, and there's a center-left side, okay? And I'm going to get a little technical, but this is an advanced seminar in religion and state in Israel and politics, so you guys will have to get it. So our coalition agreement is based on a series of agreements between the center-left parties and Yesh Atid, which is the largest party in our bloc, and the agreement between the party called Tikva Chadasha and Yamina on the right side. And then Yamina, which is sort of the lead partner on the right side, and Yesh Atid have their own agreement. And that is the coalitional agreement which binds us all. Now, on the center left side, we all made part of our agreement, all of us, the application or the implementation of the Kotel agreement, for example, okay? But it's not necessarily in the agreement between Yesh Atid and Yamina. Now, the same, our platform in blue and white, we are in favor of public transportation on Shabbat. Even though we are quite a religious party, I mean, most of the people who are ministers or members of Knesset are Shomrei Shabbat. In the non-Orthodox tradition, we have only one Orthodox Jew, but all of us are very, very traditional. I keep saying we're a conservative party, just nobody's come out of the closet yet except me. But the truth of the matter is, when the battle was over about whether or not we should have over the reform of the Kashrut laws, up until now, the Israeli chief rabbinate had a monopoly on giving out licenses for kosher restaurants and kosher food, and this government decided they wanted to make it open it up and create competition. Unfortunately, the competition is only if you have Orthodox orientation, and I argued unsuccessfully that it should involve other streams. The trouble was that none of that was in the agreement. Now, I probably could have gotten Gilad and a couple of other people to stop that, but our sense was that because it weakened the central rabbinical authority, that it was a step in the right direction. So although I was a little bit insulted, in fact, I can be honest with you, I went to talk to Yair Lapid about it, who's there. He's gonna be prime minister, I believe, in another year and a half or something. And I said to him, and he's a member of a Reform synagogue in Tel Aviv, and I said, this is crazy that we're already doing this. Let's let the conservative Orthodox, conservative Reform. He said, Alon, you're right, and I'm gonna do this, and we're gonna make it happen, and blah, blah, blah. And he was very happy. The next morning, his secretary or his head of his office called me up and said, listen, he didn't really think it through, whatever, he backtracked. And I understood that because at the time I was talking tough, and then all of a sudden they pulled the rug out from under me. And so I decided that the prudent thing to do was to let this thing go through. But at some point, you can't always be the nice guy because even with your new coalition, you have to rattle the cage a little bit So I'm not sure on which of those issues. I have a lot to say on each of them. And conversions, of course, I think that conservatives' conversion should be valid. And in terms of marriage, there's nothing in halakha that says you'd even need a rabbi. So why do we have an Orthodox rabbi? They're dead. In fact, most Israelis are starting to opt out and not go to rabbis at all. So why not? Anyway, there's a lot of things we could do. I think we have to pick our battles. And I'll probably do that in consultation with the heads of my own movement and the rabbis there. And the form will do it. And we'll try to find one or two issues we can make real progress on. I don't think we've gotten really focused on what we can make a difference. And I'm not sure that if it was my choice that I would make the Kotel the first one in terms of what I think is the most important thing for the quality of Jewish life in Israel. But I belong to a movement and I would confer and defer to their concerns. I don't think I have the expertise or the spiritual gravitas to make that call.
Thank you. So I guess we have time for two more quick questions. So I'd want to ask one, to Alon, to M. Keital, and one to Rakefet. Alon, can you talk about what you see as the most important Masorti values that can contribute to the work of the Knesset and to the future of the state of Israel? And to Rakefet, if you could speak to the Jewish Pluralism Watch program, what you see as the most important activities for 2022, and where do you see chances of success coming in the next year?
Okay, so I'll be honest with you. I also belong to a party which is a centrist party by definition. And we feel that we have a great advantage because we're the only party that can really talk to everybody. We're in good terms with the ultra-Orthodox, and we're on good terms with the leftist parties and the Arab parties and everybody because we're in the middle. And we agree. Now, a lot of people tend to look at those who sit in the middle as wishy-washy, spineless, a little bit vague, whatever. But like I said, I believe in a muscular middle, that this doesn't reflect. And in fact, just now I was asked to give in one sentence, what is the essence of my blue and white party? But I would say it's the same thing about my movement, that there's nothing about conservative Judaism that doesn't reflect a lack of values. But we have a commitment to unity and the notion that Orthodox Jews and Reform Jews and anybody have a place at the table. We have a commitment to equality, Okay, and I think that's a very critical value for Israel's future, and it has to. In fact, we just made a. We're fighting now to pass a basic law, which would supplement the nation-state law, which would say that all Israelis. We have it in our Declaration of Independence. We want to make it a basic law, and a derech eretz, which is a Hebrew concept, which means, gosh, can we have a helpful translation there? A decency, a humility. The in way you deal with people. And they say that derech eretz lefnei haTorah, one of Benny's favorite expressions, he's always saying that, that even before you have religious law, you have this fundamental imperative of being a mensch and being decent. And I think that's always been a part of the conservative movement that I found very important. And by being in the middle of the road and having that balance between, yes, we're deeply committed to preserving our tradition and everything that means and being inspired from it. But we recognize that there are new in developments in the world that we want to be part of. That is something the Knesset needs to live to and listen to. And I think it informs who I am, my own political affiliation, hopefully my activities as a legislator.
I'll answer about the Jewish Pluralism Watch and about our mission. And I think, as you have heard from Alon Tal, this is a very challenging Knesset. On one hand, this is a pro-Knesset or coalition that is a pro-Jewish pluralism, probably the most pro-Jewish pluralism that we had for many, many years. And on the other hand, there are a lot of new Knesset members that are not necessarily very involved in those issues, doesn't necessarily come with a lot of background. They have their own opinions, but not necessarily know what does it mean in terms of working in the Knesset and how that affects different laws that are coming. Alon is very unique because this is his background, but most of the other, and Gilad Kariv, which is a Reform rabbi that was mentioned, has of course the right background for that. But the other 59 are not necessarily know or understand that the same we do or the same the way we want them to be. And Jewish Pluralistic Watch, this is Jewish Pluralism Watch mission is first to get them know and understand what does it mean. Give them the information, the right information. Give them the background for everything they do, how that affected or how that going to affect Jewish pluralism in Israel. Give them a position paper about every decision and every law that is coming. And we also already see, we've talked, there is a, I'll just give you an example that was a few weeks ago. You know, this Knesset works in the middle of the night. It's very common that Alon works till 5 a.m. in the morning, all night long. It become kind of a tradition in this Knesset already in the last few months. So we saw discussions that are going, and there was a discussion about the rabbi at the Kotel, Rabbi Rabinovich, which is an ultra-Orthodox rabbi that has unlimited time to work as a Kotel, as a rabbi at the Kotel. And we wrote a position, a paper that was sent to different Knesset members. So not just Alon understood about it, and not just Gilad Kariv understood about it. We saw also Musi Raz, a Knesset member from Meretz, that I don't know when was the last time that he visited the Kotel, but he understood exactly what we talk about and stood up and said, okay, I want to bring it up. I want to bring a question. What is it? And he started a discussion about it in the Knesset, which was amazing because that was something that Knesset members that are in interested in different issues that we relate to and relate to those issues that we deal with, not necessarily see the connections because they're not religious, they don't understand in religion, they don't think Jewishly it's only ultra-Orthodox or modern Orthodox that deal with that. They don't think it's their issue. When we teach them, when we give them the right information, they know how to be more active. And we see that, and we saw that last week when Alon and I were in the same committee at the Knesset, and Julia, I lost her last name.
Malinowski.
Malinowski. Velimanovsky talked about the Kotel and how the, you know, different issues that came up, and Alon knew the information, and she asked questions. The people that were there from the Kotel asked questions, exactly the things that we brought up in the position paper that we sent her before. So it's very important knowledge that they need to have, and not each one of them have in advance. And this is something that we do by monitoring all the time the information that comes up. What are the issues? What are the discussions that's going to be next week? How can we bring them the right information at the right time? Who is the right person to ask those questions, you know, in the committee or in the parliament discussion? This is and also the advantage that we have as a Masorti movement that is in, you know, I like what you said, Alon, about very strong middle, very muscular middle. I don't know how you say that.
Muscular middle. No,
muscular middle. This is, I think it's very, very important because as a movement, we have relationship with the right and with the left, and of course, with parties in the middle. So we have a Knesset member in Yamina that lives in Hanaton, and he is a conservative Jew. And at the same time, we have Knesset members from Labor that connect with us. And of course, we have Alon in the middle. So we have Knesset member all over that can talk, and part of what we discuss and what we talk about, and we meet Knesset members from all parties. It's very important for us that on one hand, we're the conservative movement, and on the other hand, the Jewish Pluralism Watch works with every party about Jewish pluralism, not just for the movement, for the sake of the of Israel as a Jewish pluralistic state.
So first of all, I want to thank,
Can I just please. Before I get last, just a last word of sentence before I sign off, I just wanted to again reiterate how much I appreciate, and I speak on behalf of my congregation for sure, the engagement of all the participants here and your generosity in supporting the Masorti Foundation. You know, it's fairly remarkable that we were all born in an age when there is this third Jewish Commonwealth. And we have this chance to make the Jewish state the place that we know it can be. I can't think of any better way to do that, to support your movement and your ideals in Israel. So I want to thank you so much, and hopefully you'll continue to stay the course, and we will be worthy of your confidence.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
You say mechazeket v'ma'ala. Mechazeket v'ma'ala. I want to enforce what you said just now, Alon, and I want to say thank you, you know, from all of us, because it's really the support that we get from the foundation is so important and so dramatically help to for us to make this country better and to make Judaism in Israel a better Jewish state, really. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Rakefet. Thank you for your partnership with the foundation. Thank you, Alon, MK Tal. Thank you for coming and joining us. We are very committed to this partnership and to our deep, deep, deep commitment to the State of Israel. I hope that everyone here will consider ways to engage more with the Masorti movement in Israel, with the State of Israel. I hope people will join the foundation as storytellers of this wonderful, wonderful work of the Masorti movement. We are committed to helping the movement through Jewish Pluralism Watch and all of the programs expand this muscular middle in the State of Israel. And we need support from people in the community to do that. If you haven't already, I encourage people to check out the Masorti website, masorti.org. We will have materials there in the upcoming days on the issues around Yosef Kibita and the Abu Daya around the Kotel. And also, I'm very inspired that we'll figure out ways to better engage our community here on the environmental issues in Israel as an expression of the conservative Masorti movement in Israel and around the world. The movement and our partners here in the US are committed to working on this together to help the State of Israel go from strength to strength. And Alon, I hope we will see you soon in Israel, COVID permitting, and hope that you will be back with us again and again as we try and move this work forward. So if I ask everybody to do a virtual round of applause for Alon, for MKTAL, for Rakefet, and for this partnership.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everyone, for coming.